management of hypertension
is a continuing debate throughout the world. This is one area where the so-called experts, corporate hospitals, international associations have told us and brainwashed us about the evidence-based medicine. The Joint National Commission on Hypertension sat 8 times over the past 30 years, and the number of times they somersaulted, if you calculate, you will question your mind, is there at all a place for the evidence-based medicine? Therefore, I thought I'll project 2 slides from our sponsor slides and explain how to go about basically in the management of hypertension and what is the role of angiotensin and its receptor 1, 2 and the blockade. Now, basically these are the groups of drugs available to manage hypertension. Of course, the one thing that has not been mentioned in this slide is lifestyle modification. Lifestyle modification is a process that should go on and on. Includes weight reduction, which was very amply discussed by the previous speaker in a different situation, salt reduction, and alcohol abstinence, tobacco abstinence, and physical activity. It is worthwhile repeating it: weight reduction, salt reduction, alcohol abstinence, cigarettes abstinence, and physical activity. That should continue till the end. The body mass index has been very nicely defined by the Association of Physicians of India as 22. In Indian context, Western standards of 25 do not stand. 22 is the body mass index, and 1900, the hip and waist sizes. These are the standards for the Indians. You should achieve it, especially when you have got any disease after 40, started hypertension thing. You remember these 3 figures: BMI 22, hip and waist sizes 90 and 100 centimeters. You should not exceed this. Among these, the diuretic, thiazide diuretics still stands. It has been brought back in the Joint National Commission of 8. Previously discarded, thrown out, and all the other drugs were brought as a first line. But still, thiazide stands today. The advantage of thiazide is it has got an excretory capacity in the distant tubules of the sodium, so that there can be slight liberal intake of sodium. After all, many hypertensive patients, after prolonged duration of treatment, come back and tell us, after all, there is only one life to live on, and why should I not relax on salt? Thiazide diuretics does help us to relax on salt intake for some time, for some extent. And also, the thiazide diuretics has got a potentiating effect with all the other groups of drugs. If you give thiazide diuretics, the requirement of the other groups of drugs marginally come down by 20 to 28%. Therefore, it is very, very important to have a thiazide diuretics, and that has been brought back in the Joint National Commission as the first line of drug again. Of course, step ladder pattern, many things have changed. That is not good. Now, among the thiazides, the oldest one was glortheridone. It has been rebirth, now it has been brought down. The difference between conventional hydrochlorothiazide and chlorothalidone is this. Chlorothalidone definitely has got a prolonged action. It can be given once a day. But important, please remember, it is more prone to hypokalemia. When you give a chlorothalidone, please remember, it has got a more effect on producing hypokalemia. Now, with respect to the other drugs, beta blockers, they have stood the test of time. And comorbid conditions, when you have got a cardioprotective action, and when you have got a personality of the patient who is hyperreactive, beta blockers is the drug of choice. ACE inhibitors, fortunately, have 2 side effects. One is tachycardia and fetal edema, and that has to be used with caution. But still, the later introduction of ACE inhibitors they sell nedipin as a nephro-friendly action, and that is a place to go. Calcium antagonist. Among the calcium antagonists, you have got a pedal edema and the tachycardia, and the latter calcium antagonist is sildenafil. You have got a friendly, kidney-friendly role, and has got a role to play. Now we'll go on to the angiotensin converting to enzyme. Slide person. Tambi, go on to the slide person. Slow person, man. And this is the children. Continue. Midwapon. Go ahead. Next. Now, the angiotensin receptor blockade have come to stay almost as a first standard to start with, and also have come to stay in a special situation where there is a microalbuminuria. The normal 24 hours urine protein in an adult should not be more than 150 ml. It's of course slightly different in a very hot summer and things, but in the normal conditions with the urine output of 1.5 liters, it should not exceed 150 ml. When you have got a microalbuminuria, the drug of choice to start with in hepatitis management is angiotensin II receptors. And also, angiotensin receptor blockade has got increased bradykinin level. Bradykinin, which is not affected by any of the other anti-hepatitis agents, now is taken care of by the angiotensin receptor. And also, it decreases the sympathetic nervous activity, angiotensin receptor blockade. Now, angiotensin receptor blockade also, when you block a angiotensin, converting enzyme blocks the angiotensin receptor 1, you have got the activity of the angiotensin receptor 2. There's a paradox in first receptor and second receptor. Now, specifically ARBs block the angiotensin receptor 2 and they are more effective. But there is no benefit of using angiotensin converting enzyme and angiotensin receptor blocking. Many times we see, either by oversight or by not understanding, that when you use a combined pill, some prescriptions we see combination of these two, AC plus ARP. Please do not do this, because it has got a potential to accelerate the kidney damage, and potential especially in susceptible persons to increase the urea creatinine levels. Therefore, there is no role at all to combine the two drugs, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor, angiotensin receptor blockade. These two should never be combined, and there is no added advantage. And also, other advantage of angiotensin II inhibitor, they have got that augments the hypotensive effect of other drugs. Like thiazides, they also have got that augmenting the hypotensive effect of other drugs. Therefore, they have been recommended as a monotherapy. The only other groups of drugs in which ARBs do not augment the hypotensive effect is a calcium channel blockers. Some of calcium channel blockers with ARBs, the additive effect of anti-hypertensive action is not very much, as we see in other combinations like ARBs and beta blockers, ARBs and thiazides, and ARBs and alpha blockers. That the additive effect of hypotensive effect is more. Whereas with calcium channel blockers, the additive effect of ARB is less. Therefore, now, friends, apart from talking on ARB, with the pharma companies trying on you, knocking at your door with a combination of all these combination of drugs, it is definitely your individual choice to choose them. But the order of priority today, in as recommended by the Joint National Commission 8, is start with the diuretics, go with ARBs or ACE, and then add on to the drug. Of course, this order should be changed depending on the individual comorbid conditions, which I will not go into the detail now, because treatment of hypertension in the elderly after 50 is by the comorbid conditions. With this, I will stop. I sincerely thank the sponsors to give me an opportunity
to talk on that. Thank you.
Any questions, Master?